Penguin Random House Audio presents Middle of the Night, a novel by Riley Sager. Read for you by Santino Fontana. To Patricia Cole, I think you would have loved this one. Saturday, July 16th, 1994, 6:37 a.m. Morning sunlight seeps into the tent like a water leak, dripping onto the boy in a muted glow. The trickle of light on his cheeks wakes him from a deep slumber. He opens his eyes just a little, his vision hazy through a web of lashes still sticky with sleep. Peering up at light-tinted orange by the tent's fabric, he tries to pinpoint the position of the sun, wondering what time it is and if his mother is already awake, sipping coffee in the kitchen, waiting for them to come in for breakfast. It's stuffy inside the tent. The July heat never abated during the night and now fills the air, thick and heavy. He'd wanted to keep the tent flap open while they slept, but his father said mosquitoes could get in. So the flap remains zipped shut, trapping the heat, which mingles with the distinct smells of boys in summertime. Grass and sweat, bug spray and sunblock, morning breath and body odor. He wrinkles his nose at the smell and feels a pop of sweat on his brow as he rolls over in his sleeping bag. It feels safe, like a hug. Although awake, he doesn't want to get up just yet. He prefers to stay exactly where he is, as he is. A boy on a lazy Saturday morning, smack dab in the middle of a lazy summer. His name is Ethan Marsh. He is 10. And this is the last carefree moment he'll have for the next 30 years. Because just as he's about to close his eyes again, he notices another bit of light. A bright vertical slit glowing on the side of the tent. Strange. Strange enough to make him sit up, eyes now fully open, taking in the single slash in the fabric that runs from the top of the tent all the way to the ground. It's slightly puckered, like skin that's just been sliced. Through the gap, he sees a sliver of familiar yard. Freshly cut grass, light blue sky, the glare of sun that's only just now clearing the distant trees. Seeing it, Ethan is hit by a realization he's vaguely known since waking, but is only now beginning to understand. He is in a tent, in his own backyard, completely alone. But when he went to sleep the night before, there had been someone else with him. Someone now gone. Chapter 1.
Screech!
I wake with a start, unnerved by the sound zipping across the dark room. It echoes off the walls and snakes back to me in multiple waves. I lie in bed completely still, eyes wide open, until the noise fades. Not that it was ever there to begin with. Decades of experience have taught me that it was just in my head. Dream, memory, and hallucination, all at once. My first since coming back to this house. Honestly, I'm surprised it took so long, especially with the anniversary of what happened here fast approaching. Sitting up, I look to the clock on the nightstand, hoping it reads closer to dawn than midnight. No such luck. It's only 2:15. I've got a long night of no sleep ahead of me. With a sigh, I reach for the notebook and pen I keep next to the clock. After much squinting in the darkness, I find a fresh page and scribble 4 frustrating words. Had the dream again. I toss the notebook back onto the nightstand, followed by the pen. It lands with a clack against the notebook's cover before rolling onto the carpet. I tell myself to leave the pen there until morning, that nothing will happen to it overnight. But the bad thoughts arrive quickly. What if the pen leaks, its midnight black ink staining the cream-colored carpet? What if I'm attacked in the middle of the night and the only thing I can use to defend myself is an uncapped Bic, which now sits out of reach? That second one, as alarming as it is improbable, pulls me out of bed. I grab the pen and set it on the notebook. There. Much better. Anxiety soothed. For now. I'm about to crawl back under the covers when something outside catches my attention. A light. Not unusual for Hemlock Circle. Despite the lack of streetlights, it's never completely dark here. Light spills through bay windows onto immaculate front lawns and brightens second-floor bedrooms before the sun rises and long after it sets. The sconces flanking the Chen's front door burn from dusk to dawn, warding off both trespassers and the bats that occasionally try to roost in the eaves. All summer long, the Wallace's backyard pool glows an alien blue. At Christmas, lights twinkle at 5 of the 6 homes in the neighborhood, including the Patels, who put theirs up at Diwali and don't take them down until a new year begins. Then, there are the garage lights. Every house has them. A pair of motion-activated security lights centered above the garage doors that glare like headlights when triggered. In the evenings, they flick on and off around the cul-de-sac with the frequency of fireflies, as residents return from work in the waning light, go out to fetch the mail, haul recycling bins to the curb. As it gets closer to midnight, a few will continue to spring to life. When deer skulk through the neighborhood on their way to the woods, or when Fritz Vandeveer sneaks out for a cigarette after his wife Alice has gone to bed. The light that's caught my attention is the one above the Patel's garage, 2 houses away. It illuminates a patch of their driveway, the glow turning the asphalt ice white. Curious, I go to one of the windows in a bedroom I still don't consider my own, not technically. The room that once was mine, and in my mind still is, sits across the hall, now vacant. This is my parents' bedroom, where I rarely ventured as a child. Now, though, through a series of recent developments I'm still grappling with, it's become my own. The windows in this new room offer a panorama of Hemlock Circle. From where I stand, I can see at least a piece of every house on the cul-de-sac. I glimpse a sliver of the old Barringer place on the left and a corner of the Chen's house to the right. Across from me, in full view from left to right, are the Vandeveers, the Wallaces, and the Patels, where the garage light still glows. What I don't see is anything that could have set it off. Mitesh and Deepika Patel are presumably inside and fast asleep. No animals scurry from the light, no wind blows that could have caused a nearby branch to sway hard enough to trigger the motion sensor. All I can see is an empty driveway on a quiet cul-de-sac in the dead of night. Soon I can't even see that, for the Patel's garage light suddenly goes out. 10 seconds later, the one at the Wallace's house clicks on. It's next door to the Patel's, separated by the single road that leads into the cul-de-sac, which is currently free of cars, free of people, free of anything. I draw close to the window, my nose almost touching the glass, straining to see something, any small thing, that could have triggered the light above the Wallace's garage. There's nothing. Nothing visible, that is. Still, I stay pressed to the window, watching, even after the Wallace's garage light clicks off. The only thing I can think of that could have triggered it is a bat. They thrive here, as the Chen's porch lights can attest, feeding off the many insects that live in the woods circling the cul-de-sac. They are also notoriously difficult to see in the darkness. But then the light above the Vandeveer's garage springs to life, and I know my theory is wrong. Bats flit willy-nilly, chasing prey. They don't methodically move from house to house. No, this is different. This is worrisome. Unease spreads through my chest as I think about 30 years ago. I can't help it, not after what happened here. When the Vandeveer's light turns off, I begin to count. 5 seconds. Then 10. then a full minute. Long enough for me to think that whatever is out there has moved on, likely into the woods, which means it was an animal. Something simply too small and quick for me to spot, but not small and quick enough to evade the hair-trigger garage lights of the houses on Hemlock Circle. The tightness in my chest eases.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.